problem that we have today, and he's destroyed many minds of present truth believers. So I will try and summarize it as much as I can, but it is something that you need to go and study for yourself. So before we begin, I'd like us to seek the Lord.
Showing, but we need to, we
something that we have to go and study. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the forehead of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And he causeth all, both small and great, rich, poor and free, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in. You know, all the translations add that in terms say on. And that is deliberate. That's the confusion. In the forehead. And that signifies our frontal lobe. Okay? And so the Bible is very keen about the forehead. And even when you look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, it says that these things, they shall be between the frontlets of your eye, in the forehead. The teachings that God has given us should be in our mind. Okay? And I saw thrones and beasts, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither its image, neither received its mark upon their foreheads, okay, or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. So the Bible is very keen about what we put in our forehead, and God wants to be the ruler of our mind. Our God communicates to us through the mind, okay? God doesn't communicate through the hand or the leg. He talks to us through the intelligence that he put for us in our mind. And so, I would like us to the book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 11 says, and have no fellowship with what? The unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. And you know that Hollywood is the source of most of the content that we get in form of movies, video games, and a lot of the stuff that goes on to the television that we watch. And Hollywood, given by that name, is a name that is derived from a tree that was used for witchcraft. Okay? So I think we need to understand where these things come from. Alright? And the movies from Hollywood, even for very small kids, they are actually witchcraft. Okay? And your birth has been under the spell of the devil. From an early age, we are exposed to satanic spell in the form of entertainment. How many people have seen cartoons of rooms that are walking around? You know, that's not real. But you know, we always feed this content to kids who are so young and so susceptible. Okay? Most of the movies out of Hollywood are about the occult, right? And I don't know if, I don't need to try and explain that. I mean, it's so obvious. I mean, there's a movie, and I'd like to show you a movie that came out, I didn't know, came out this year called Black Panther. You guys heard about that? Yeah. It's all about witchcraft, and it's trying to show that witchcraft is okay. Speaking to the dead is fine. And that's just one. There are so many that have been coming out in the previous year. So I'm just giving you something that is relevant now. You know, it tries to promote witchcraft as normal. Demon possession as something fashionable. Even some of the musical musicians like Rihanna, in some of their movie the musicals, they get demon possessed and they show it to you. I told you that I had an experience of praying to a demon-possessed person. It's not something that you smile about. It's a serious thing. Demon activity is very, very present, especially in our country here. But you know, out there, they want to show it as fashionable. And yet the devil is possessing many, many more people today. And when you present yourself in the devil's temple, you are ready for possession. Disney was a 33rd degree Mason. Alright? And Masonry is the highest level of Luciferian worship, or the worship of Satan. I believe the Church of Satan must have set up shop in Kenya at some point. Alright? You guys know the Church of Satan? Church of Satan.
Yes.
Yeah. And they have their Bible. And so I didn't want to speak much about Masonic works, but we know that Freemasonry is very rife in Kenya. We even have a lodge in Nairobi, not far from our church, the Central Church. In fact, they were saying some time back that people were begging to be members of the Freemasonry because they have heard that when you become a member, you are instantly rich, very rich. It is a serious thing, and we have church members. Nairobi Central Church members. There's a lady came there one time during her meeting and she said she's a Mason and she would like to speak. And of course the elder said, no, 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 it's not possible. She said, but why? Like, so many of my colleagues are here. And you know, people were shocked. So Freemasonry is there even among the remnant. And Masonic Freemasonry at its highest level is the worship of Satan. From the 30th degree to the 33rd degree, they know that they are worshipping Satan. The lower levels may not know. And Walt Disney was a Freemason. And these guys who produce the movies from Hollywood, their movies are dedicated to Satan. Revelation 18 verse 23 says, and the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee. And the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men of the... This is Babylon. Think about Babylon. Thy merchants were the great men of the earth. For by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. Sorcery. Sorcery. What God said that for rebellion is as the sin of... Witchcraft. So, rebellion is measured by witchcraft. And so, for God, witchcraft is so bad. Okay? And so, we are dealing with sorceries at the highest level. The entertainment industry is leading a rebellion against God unless we are careful. The content from the media will cast a spell on us. Right? So, it's very easy to call those guys, the demons, to come and possess. What does sorcery mean? It comes from the Greek word pharmakia, the use or the administering of drugs. Have you heard of the word pharmacy? Yeah. It comes from that Greek word pharmakia, which means the use or the administering of drugs. You see that symbol there? It also means poisoning. Sorcery, magical arts, often found in connection with idolatry and fostered by it. Right? Deceptions and seductions of idolatry. So that is what sorcery is. Okay? Anything that medicates our mind so that we can follow that we cannot follow the will of God is considered sorcery. When you set your mind in a way that you don't know what you're doing, then you are bewitched. God dwells in our mind, he can only communicate to us through our minds. Alright? So the frontal lobe, that is the part that deals with spirituality, morality, and the will. Okay? And so, remember 1 Corinthians 3:16 says, know ye not that ye are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Okay? Those who would not fall a prey to Satan's devices must guard well the avenues of the soul. They must avoid seeing or hearing that which will suggest impure thoughts. The mind must not be left to dwell at random upon every subject that the enemy of souls may suggest. The heart must be faithfully sentineled, or evils within will awaken evils, evils without will awaken evils within, and the soul will wander in darkness. You know, when I was small, I listened to a lot of secular music, right? And I don't know if I mentioned this to you, that when you hear or see something, it remains in your mind, in your brain, until the day you die. It doesn't go away. Your brain, you do not have a dustbin. You know, at home we have dustbins, right? And you throw all the rubbish in the dustbin, and when the dustbin is full, what do? You take it away. And so you don't see it again. But your brain does not have a dustbin. If you see something vile, if you see something nice, if you hear an immoral song, or you hear a nice song or phrase, all of them are stored in your brain. And they are there until the day you die. So when you're talking about evils within, all those impure thoughts, all the immoral sins, the pictures we have seen, anything that we have seen bad, the devil always wants to use that opportunity to awaken us and tempt us. And so sometimes I find myself, that song that I had when I was in standard 3, it comes back ringing in my mind. I said, where did this come from? So be careful what you put in your brain, because you can't get that. Even God cannot get that. Yes, you can renew your mind, but the sins, the temptations that have gone into your brain will always be a thorn on your flesh until the day. That's why Christianity is always a battle. We have to battle with evil until the day we are laid in the grave, or until Jesus comes back. Our brain is a very wonderful organism that God has given us. It stores a lot of information. So you need to filter what you want to get into your brain. Hypnosis is a mental state of heightened suggestibility, characterized by trance-like sleep. This is variously achieved by repetition of instructions in a low-level voice, or having the subject fix his gaze upon a light in an otherwise dark room. Have you ever seen somebody reading his phone and his mouth is open? And you're calling the person and they can't even see you. Have you seen that? They are hypnotized. You completely are oblivious of your surroundings. You are just fixed on that screen. And if you have seen most people watching television, they are on their own. You can't even talk to them. You have to wait until the program ends. That is called hypnosis. And they say that when a television screen, if you look at most television programs, the picture changes every 4 seconds. You count one, two, at the most. Sometimes it changes much more quickly. But at the most, a good TV program must change every 4 seconds. Anybody who's done media here, I'm sure you should have been taught that in school, right? It should change every 4 seconds in order to hypnotize the viewer, in order to hold the viewer's attention. Because the objective of the programmers is to hold your attention. Enter. Entertain. Entertainment. Enter means to. Is to possess. And. Tainment means to maintain in possession. Entertainment. In the future, Satan's superstitions will assume new forms. Errors will be presented in a pleasing and flattering manner. False theories clothed with garments of light will be presented to God's people. Thus Satan will try to deceive, if possible, the very elect. Most seducing influences will be exerted. Minds will be hypnotized. Testimonies, Volume 8. Our prophet saw that in future, minds will be what? Hypnotized. There was no television during the viewing study. How did she know this? Minds will be hypnotized. Cut away from yourselves everything that savors of hypnotism, the science by which satanic agencies work. Anything that savors hypnotism, you've heard it from the prophet, we should cut away. That is the science by which satanic agencies work. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Okay? 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. And so, the mind goes through different stages of awareness. When you are in the alpha stage, you are you are awake, and then when you get into the better, and when you're going to sleep, you get into the, is it the better stage? Where is my wife? Can you tell me about this stage, the sleep pattern? All right? So there is a stage in between sleep and awakeness, and that is the stage that is for hypnosis. You are not quite asleep, and you are not quite awake. And that is the stage that many of entertainers would like to get you at. And that is the stage of hypnosis. Alright? So that's a brain wave, it's a delta wave, it's deep sleep. Okay? The theta wave is light sleep. Right? And the alpha wave, you are awake, relaxed. Beta, you are awake and excited. Alright? So the light sleep, the light sleep is the stage that you would like when you're about to drowse, you're about to drowse off and you start seeing some things. That is the stage that you usually get, alright? Now, this is the power of the mission. I don't want you guys to go and read this book, but just something for us to learn. It's an American Wicca high priestess, one of the most high profile witches in the world, one of the first people to popularize witchcraft in the US, and author of several books. What does she say? The science of witchcraft is based on our ability to enter an altered state of consciousness called alpha. Okay? In alpha, the mind opens up to non-ordinary forms of communication, such as telepathy, clairvoyance, precognition. Here we also may experience out-of-body sensations and psychokinesis, or receive mystical vision, information that does not come through the five senses. In alpha, the rational filters that process ordinary reality are weakened or removed, and the mind is receptive to non-ordinary realities. Okay? Alpha is the springboard for all psychic and magical workings. It is the heart of witchcraft. You must master it first before proceeding to any other spell, ritual, or exercise. So when you get into the alpha state, then you are open to all manner of possession. Mystics in every religious tradition speak of alpha state of consciousness and the view of divine light, although they do so in their own metaphors and image. In their own ways, they have learned how to enter alpha as they pray and worship. And there is some music that puts us in alpha state. There is music, everything, music, whether it is of whatever kind, if it has got the signature, the right signature, it puts you in an alpha state. What happens in your brain when you watch television? Okay, you've got the left and the right brain. The left brain, analytical, logical, and the right brain, emotional, artistic. Okay? And we encourage to use both sides of the brain. When you watch TV, your brain switches from predominantly all brain thinking to right brain. Emotional, all that, alright? Artistic and dreaming. The left side of your brain shuts down. You are no longer able to critically analyze the information coming through your five senses. That is why you can see somebody being shot on television and it's okay. Because the left brain is shut down. Just emotional, and you are not seeing that what you are seeing is wrong. You shouldn't be seeing that. How do they make you be able to endure those kind of scenes? They have to put you in an alpha state where this side of the brain shuts down. When that switch happens, your body releases endorphins and the body's natural opiate. It hooks up to some receptor sites in your body, as does opium or heroin. Hence the definition of pharmakia or sorcery. So it makes your body generate those endorphins and you become, you essentially medicate yourself into hypnosis. Okay? So you're dealing with a very powerful drug and you become addicted to your body's natural opiates when you watch television. You don't need to take drugs to be addicted. We'll go through, if you try to stop, you go through the same withdrawal symptoms as does a drug addict. Headaches, insomnia, irritability, and all that. Okay, the horror of television is that the information goes in, but we do not react to it. It goes right into our memory pool, and perhaps we react training yourself not to react. And so later on, you're doing things without knowing why you're doing them or where they're coming from. So you're training yourself to relax when you see an immoral scene, when you see someone being cut off his head, when you see whatever kind of, you know, scene, you are basically training yourself to just relax. It goes into your subconscious mind, and it will spring back later. You train yourself not to react, you also begin to react to things without knowing why. The advertising industry knows this very well. They show you scenes very quickly, they show you things, and then later when you are in the shop, you just find yourself going to that shop and buying that item without knowing why. You find, I think I like this, let me get a thing. Because you have been trained before. All the pornography we see in the media, after some time we start reacting to it. But of course the consequences are permanent. Over 3,000 papers have been written on the effect of TV, but you won't see that in the public media. Okay? Then there is also the subliminal content. There is that content that you don't see. Okay? A lot of media programming is filled with subliminal messages that are designed to change your values and the way you respond. Is in movies, ads, and television, especially in movies, they have so much subliminal content. You know, this movie, Lion King, only saw Lion King. Oh, you guys have never seen Lion King. Huh? It's a cartoon. Lion King. Don't be scared. Just Lion King. Okay. For those who people in raising their hands, that movie had so much adult content. It was not meant for children. It had so much subliminal content that, and sadly, that it was targeting children. What can you see there? Anything? That's just a nice drawing, isn't it?
No.
Huh?
Snakes.
Subliminal one. You know, this scene will just come up and go. Something else comes. Can anybody? It's just a nice flower.
Okay.
Can you see that? Subliminal content. And you will see such pictures, so many pictures, and you won't know that they are actually passing messages to you. Your subconscious mind picks that. You may not see it in your conscious, but your subconscious mind sees that. Okay? Anything you can see there? Just a nice kind of... you know, these things are not done by chance. Everything has been properly done.
Pepsi.
It's just a part of
sex.
You can see that? Well, the fact is that 99% of our households, we have television. So when you see somebody shooting another person on television, it is registered in your mind that you are the one to. Your subconscious mind thinks that you are the one who did. And if you notice, most thugs who go to rob banks, they normally watch videos of bank robbers. There is no school I know in Kenya that trains robbers. So how do they do it? They watch, because in their subconscious mind it registers that they are them doing it. And they watch many times, and when they get guns, they're just acting out what they saw. So do not train yourself to see yourself. But I know that television is not really the big problem. I just like us to look at something else. One that bothers us most. The smartphone. I know this is a problem, but this is the problem that we have today among the present true believers. Brothers and sisters, we will see. The devil knows that you study your Bible. He knows that you are good in the spirit of prophecy. He knows that you will not eat meat or drink milk or take sugar. So the only one way he's going to get you through this money. You can have all the nice groups, closed groups, about how you will share the message. There is social media. What is the meaning of the word social media? Social media. Does that sound like a serious classroom for study? I'm just asking you, social media. Does that remind you of a serious place where you can share inspirational material in a social media? Does it? I know many of you guys are really okay, but let's see. How does your smartphones affect our brain? There are various things that we will discuss, how they affect our memory, how they affect our behavior. Let's see. All day long, somebody, this is material that was done by some secular paper. This guy, all day long, we are inundated by interruptions and alerts from our devices. Smartphones buzz to wake us up, emails stream into our inboxes, notifications from co-workers and parent friends bubble up on our screen, and assistants chiming with their own soulless voices. Okay? Such interruptions seem logical to our minds, but our bodies have a different view. Okay? These constant alerts, they jolt our stress hormones into action, igniting our fight or flight response. Our heartbeats quicken, our breathing tightens, our sweat glands burst open, and our muscles contract. That response is intended to help us to outrun danger, not answer a call or a text. We are simply not built to live like that. So when you get the response, that adrenaline response, it's supposed to be when you see a leopard or a snake. Not some picture of, oh, now I'm not feeling well. Get a funny picture on WhatsApp. And it jolts you up. You are on an adrenaline high. And imagine how many of those things you get during the day. And 90% of college students now report feeling phantom phone vibration. How many of you guys have had your phone ringing and it was not ringing? It happened. You can actually, did my phone ring? And it's not ringing. They have reported that also. Imagining their phone is summoning them to attention when it has actually buzzed. But it hasn't actually buzzed. 86% of Americans say they check their email and social media accounts constantly. And that's really stressing them out. Okay? Alright, so there's that prefrontal cortex. That's with empathy, insight, response, flexibility, emotion regulation, body regulation. See, look at number 6, morality. Morality is managed by that prefrontal cortex, okay? Intuition, attuned communication, fear, modulation, any of the limbic brain, fight, flight, freeze, stress, response, think, I'm safe, if people want me, emotions, they live there, okay? Now, endocrinologist Robert Lustig says, notifications from our phones are training our brains to be in a nearly constant state of stress and fear by establishing a stress-fear memory pathway. And such state means that the prefrontal cortex, the part of our brain that normally deals with some of our highest order cognitive function, goes completely haywire. And basically does what? Shuts down. Just like hypnosis, when you are hypnotized, that frontal lobe shuts down. And that means that your ability to tell whether something is morally right or wrong is impaired, is affected. That is why you can see an immoral sin and you are not moved. You end up doing stupid things and those things get you into trouble. The word addiction is derived from a Latin term for enslaved by or bound to. Addiction exerts a long and powerful influence on the brain that manifests in 3 different distinct ways. Craving for the object of addiction, loss of control over its use, and continuing involvement with it despite adverse consequences. I know many of us can forget our Bibles at home, but can you forget the home? You'll be messed up. You must go back for it by all means. The Bible is okay, but the phone, you cannot live without it. And that is a problem. Alright? Addictive pleasure isn't the same as true happiness. Look at addictive pleasure. Dopamine. It sends, creates nerves under the cerebral cortex. And what does it do? There are only 5 receptors, and the neurotransmitter fuels desire and motivation. Addictive. The true happiness, serotonin, it's not addictive. Short term, like enjoying a piece of cake, you know, it's very sweet and very nice, but for a very short time. But true happiness, serotonin, long term, it's like contentment. Addictive, dopamine, it's visceral, it's felt in the body. Ethereal, it's felt above the neck. Addictive, it inspires taking, like cashing in your chips at the casino. It inspires you to take. But serotonin, it inspires you to give, like volunteering, okay? And typically, for the addictive, it's experienced alone. If you've noticed, and I've seen this, we sometimes, the time they used to go for meetings, and so we reach somewhere, and everybody just gets out their phone, and they are busy on their phone. There are many of people in the room, but everybody is just alone. There is no conversation. You know, they say that social media is not so social. It's actually antisocial. Because you can be sitting at home with your brothers and sisters and you're not even talking. Because you're on your what? On your smartphone, checking your messages. You are so antisocial. Can't even speak to the person sitting next to you in a public vehicle because you're just deep in your phone. So how is it social? We call it social. You know, the devil likes to mock us. Okay? So you like to enjoy that alone. Okay? Too much leads to addiction, right? And so you can see there the difference. We should, and when you are in this state of addiction, you cannot read something sober. Because you're always on a high state of alert. The other thing about multitasking. Scientists have known for years that people often won't admit to themselves. Humans can't really multitask. And it's true for most of the 97%. Well, most people like say, oh, me, I can multitask. You cannot. Most, very few people do that. Okay? But since only about 1 in 50 are super taskers, the rest of us, mere mortals, are really only focusing on just one thing at a time. That means every time we pause to answer a new notification or get a new alert from a different application on our phone, we are being interrupted. And with that interruption, we may pay a price, something called a switch cost. Imagine if you are cooking something, and every time you try to do the cooking, somebody, your child comes and interrupts you. And so you have to attend to the child, and then you go back to cook. What will the food come out? It will not come out the right way, because there is a cost. That moment that you have to stop, rather you have to switch off the fire, go and attend to the interruption, come back. And before you go far, another interruption comes. That's what happens with our phones. In a day of flip-flopping between ideas, conversations, and transactions on a phone or a computer, our switch costs can really add up and make us more error-prone. So having accidents. Every time we switch tasks, we are also shooting ourselves up with a dose of stress hormone, cortisol. The switching puts our thoughtful reasoning prefrontal cortex to sleep and kicks up dopamine, our brain's addiction chemical. Alright? So when you are interrupted, cortisol is produced. When you see a picture of a friend on your WhatsApp, cortisol is produced. When you see a message that just come up, cortisol is produced. And cortisol has actually been known to lead to cancer. Too much cortisol in the system is very harmful for you. Okay? And so, how does that affect our memory? These smartphones that we have, how do they affect our memory? Reading up on new information on your phone can be a very terrible way to learn. Okay? But I told you guys, when you finish here, go and sit down, get a book, and read these things And I've been telling guys that your brain stores information in pictures. When you read something, like now in this room, as I look at you, my brain is taking many pictures. Just pictures. And so when I go back home, I say, how was the room? It was very nice. I can remember some people sitting there. I can remember these guys here. You know, you remember by seeing the whole, and not just a portion, not just the voice. Our brain likes to have a complete experience. And so when you hold a book like this, yesterday I read an article on this magazine, and I remember it by the location of that article. And if you remember, if you're in school those days and you wrote notes, you remember in the exam room the answer to the question based on the location where you were written the notes. But now when you have a computer screen, everything is the same. The pages just keep flipping, and so your brain has trouble trying to store anything. And so you forget things as fast as you read them. That is why Google is laughing all the way to the lab. Because they know that if you can't remember anything, you have to keep searching. An obvious difference between PC screens and paper is that paper is material. You can feel the weight, texture, and thickness of a pump or a book. You can see where it begins and ends. You can quickly leaf through the pages with your fingers. This perceptible direct experience gives you a mental map of the entire text. The brain has an easier task when you can touch as well as see. And so that's why these presentations I've been giving here will be forgotten as fast as possible. Unless you go somewhere, you want to read and remember these things, go and print them out on a piece of paper or in paper, something, staple them, and then read them slowly. You will be able to remember. Or get the hard copy of the book and study, and you will remember. I remember the Great Controversy, chapter 36. I remember how that chapter, which part of the page in my Bible, my Bible has got the conflict series. So I know where it starts and what it talks about by virtue of its location and how it feels in my Bible. So when I get it in another book, it takes a little while before I get used to it. Researchers have shown that people who take in complex information from a book instead of a screen develop deeper comprehension and engage in more conceptual thinking. So it's always good to avoid using your phone as the Bible, as the hymnal, as the tool for information. No, that's not how we were trained. Okay, it is God who told Moses to write. The things I've told you, write them in a book. So the writing concept God gave man directly, because he knows how we are created. In research published this month, psychologists and computer scientists have found an unusual and potentially troubling connection. The more tapping, clicking, and social media posting and scrolling people do, the noisier their brain signals become. When a brain signal is noisier, it means the brain can't store it very well. Okay? The combination of socializing and using our smartphones could be putting a huge tax on our brain, and you actually waste a lot of energy on the social media. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. I just wanted to say that, I didn't have as much time, but I would like to say that the social media was created as a platform of idolatry. It was designed for people to have a moment of fame. And so as much as we have tried to twist it to our liking, remember that it was a tool from the hand of the devil. And that is why it has a huge following. Billions of people are on social media. How can we also want to join in that bandwagon? children think, you might say that you are able to discern and you can withstand the temptation. But what about the small children who are waiting for their turn to own a phone and get a social media? And then another thing I see, parents are giving their children phones at a very early age. Phones are very damaging for children. Not only are they damaging to their head, where the brain has not, the protective covering of the brain has not fully formed, we need to avoid children, and it affects their development. We need to avoid giving our phones or leaving them around for our children to play. But they have an equally damaging effect even on adults. Let us use the phones responsibly. The phones were created to convey messages. You can send a message or you can make a phone call. They were never meant for us to read. They were never meant for us to engage in wasting time on frivolous social media. We can't use, even that one itself is a rebuke to us. That is a social media. It's not a media for us to have. Is this a social meeting? Is this a social gathering?
Yes.
No. You can clear, the mind knows that there is a time and a season for everything under the sun. And so let us not fall into that trap. Hey, you know, we have this Bible study on WhatsApp. That's just a way for us to something about our conscience, right? To just make our conscience, to soothe our conscience. Yeah. But the dangers that are there are more than the benefits you can get. And my appeal to you is keep off. It wastes your time, and I'm sure if I ask people to be honest, it wastes a lot of our time. And then you don't even remember anything. You want to read something and get it and retain it to be able to share with somebody, get a hard copy. Get away from social media. That is my prayer. And be not conformed to what?
To this world.
Why should we conform ourselves to this world? But be ye transformed by the renewing of our mind, that you may prove what is good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. I don't know if there are any questions. I told you this is a study, and I'd like to have a study on television, and I'd like to have a study on phones. There are other issues about phones. I mean, it's a very deep thing. I just assume that by the fact that you are present true believers, we should know these things. We need to study. We need to take time and study. The effect of music. I know somebody in the sun will speak about music tomorrow. But there are many things that the devil has got up to be for us present true believers. We need to be on our alert, right? So that we do not, in the process, find ourselves worshipping something other than the creator of heaven and earth. Remember the first angel's message? Worship him that made who? Heaven and earth. There are issues about pictures. Pictures. What does the Bible say about pictures? I have a problem with pictures. And because social media is mainly about pictures. Pictures. What does the Bible say about pictures? Numbers 33. From verse 50 up to 52. Please come and read for us.
By Jordan near Jericho, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when ye are passed over Jordan into the land of Canaan, then ye shall drive out all the inhabitants of the land before you, and destroy all their pictures, and destroy all their molten images, and quite pluck down all their high places.
The Lord said,
thou shalt not make unto thee any
any likeness of anything that is in that or whatever. I just want to ask you, my brothers and sisters, what does the Bible say about pictures and images?
When you read the book of Ezekiel chapter 23 from verses 13, these things of hanging are pictures on the wall. It's not something that came out yesterday. Look at what the Bible says, Ezekiel chapter 23 from verse 13. Then I saw that she was defiled, that they took both one way, and that she increased her whoredoms, for when she saw men portrayed where? Upon the wall, the images of the Chaldeans portrayed with vermilion, guarded with girdles upon their loins, exceeding in dyed attire upon their heads, all of them princes to look to, after the manner of Babylonians of Chaldee, the land of their nativity. And as soon as she saw them with her eyes, she doted, she lusted, there was an impression that was created in the mound upon them, and sent messengers unto them in Chaldee. So this created immorality, it created all these things that we were seeing, adultery and fornication and all these things. They used to have their images and people would look at them. So the things of hanging pictures on the walls, taking the selfies and all these things, it's not something that started yesterday. We think these are new inventions, but they are not.
I am asking you guys, because this is a form of idolatry that is the devil has sneaked into us. Present true beliefs. Pictures. What is the effect of pictures? When I look at a picture of myself, does that make me love Jesus more? Does it improve my Christian experience? What about when I look at the picture of my friend? Oh, she just sent me a nice picture. She's in a nice outfit. Does that make me look upward? I want us to be very honest about ourselves, because I see this thing a form of idolatry that nobody wants to talk about. And clearly the Bible is talking about destroying all their pictures in the manner of the Babylonians and the Chaldeans. This is not the manner of God's children. This is the manner of the world. Pictures. And what is 70 or 90% of social media? It is pictures.
Connected, selected message to two, chapter 33, no, other words. Those who are smartphones.
I just want us to think about that, because we have accepted it as standard. You know, I used to have my graduation picture. You know, when you finish graduation, the first thing you must do is to go where? To a studio. Before you return the gown, you must have the pictures. It's a form of idolatry. Now, if those old-fashioned pictures on the wall were idolatry, what about the ones on our phones? There's no difference. Now we don't have walls. We have walls in social media, don't we? Yes?
Everyone speaks about photography and pictures, and she speaks of this species of idolatry. And what I like about Facebook is you like showing your face. And then someone tells you, you look so nice. Mm. Even when the lady is wrongly dressed as an Adventist, you say, you look nice. And you as an Adventist are complimenting another Adventist who is wrongly dressed. The picture. And then I used to read when Edward speaks about it. And she says, this money is worse than wasted. The amount of money we used to waste on photos. These days we take photos, but we may not develop them. Now, I was thinking maybe we're not spending so much money on them. But now the number of photo albums we keep is so great. So the amount of time and money we spend on ourselves, we have become that God.
I make a comment
for that quotation, because it's always good to.
Selected messages.
Selected messages.
No other words. Chapter
33. Okay. All right, it's easier. It's a selected messages, chapter 33. Every true child of God will be sifted as wheat in the sifting process. Every cherished pleasure which diverts the mind from God must be sacrificed. Every cherished pleasure that diverts the mind from God must be sacrificed. In many families, the mantel shelves, stands, and tables are filled with ornaments and pictures. I don't want you guys to leave here saying, Buruchara is telling us things. No. It is from the Word of God. Okay? In many families, the mantel shelves, stands, and tables are filled with ornaments and pictures. Albums filled with photographs of the family and their friends are placed where they will attract the attention of visitors. Thus, the thoughts which should be upon God and heavenly interests are brought down to common things. Is not this a species of idolatry? Should not the money thus spent have been used to bless humanity, to relieve the suffering, to clothe the naked, and to feed the hungry? And I will also add, is in the time thus spent, looking at those people, have been used for helping humanity, not just the money. Should it not be placed in the Lord's treasury to advance his cause and build up his kingdom on earth? This matter is of great importance, and it is urged upon you to save you from the sin of idolatry. Blessing would come to your souls if you would obey the word spoken by the Holy One of Israel. At verse we read, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Pictures. Okay, there's something else here. Youths have their hearts filled with the love of self. This is manifested in their desire to see their faces. The girl typed by the artist. You know, they used to sit there and But now today you can just do a selfie. Yeah. Alright? And they are not satisfied with being once represented, but sit again and again for their picture. It is not enough to just take one selfie. You can take it again and again. Alright? Each time hoping that the last will exert all the previous efforts and appear really more beautiful than the original. Hey, let me have to say this one. Their lost money is squandered in this way. And what is gained? Merely their poor shadow upon paper.
Now remember, time is money. So when he says that money is spent, it's like you are losing time for making money to do something which is helpful. Yeah.
And remember, when you look at a picture, it creates an emotional response. You are on an emotional high. Cortisol is generated. It affects you even health-wise. You see different pictures, you get emotionally drained. The hours that should have been devoted to prayer are occupied upon their own poor selves. Precious hours of probation are thus wasted. Thank you for that quotation. Cleanse your homes of the picture idols, okay, which have consumed the money that ought to have been flowed into the Lord's. You see how those fellows are trying to tell us what it's about, I don't know what. Anyway, flowed into the Lord's treasury. The light must go forth as a lamp that burneth. Those who bear the message to the world should seek the Lord earnestly, that his Holy Spirit may be abundantly showered upon them. You have no time to lose. Pray for the power of God that you may work with success for those nigh and afar. I appeal to you. Pictures. Pictures. Destroy those pictures. Get rid of the medium that tempts you to worship pictures. Whether of yourself, of your friends, or of anything in the heavens, or on earth, or under the earth, we have been told, do not make a graven image. Okay? Yes?
I just wanted us to go into the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verse 9, just concerning the television.
55 of Isaiah.
Verse number 9. And not to say, sorry, Psalms. Psalms 55.
And I'm there.
Destroy, O Lord, and divide their tongues, for I have seen violence and strife in the city. Day and night they go about it, upon the walls thereof. Mischief also and sorrow are in the midst of it. Wickedness is in the midst thereof. Deceit and guile depart not from her streets.
You see, when you talk about the television, it's always on the wall. And I think also what it brings is violence and strife in the city. And nowadays, before when we used to, when the TVs were there, they used to just go up for around 12 days. But now it's 24 hours, day and night. If you want to watch the television, you are there until, and also on concerning, there is this issue, when Mary Magdalene met Christ, when the bottle which she had, she didn't open the bottle, she broke the bottle. You know, there are sometimes now, also I'm a victim, we have some photos which before we became Christians, we always want to look at our past. But remember when she came from that prostitution, she could not want to go back there. And that's why she would have retained that bottle. And is now to use it now, this the bottle I used to anoint Christ. But she broke the bottle to forget about her past and also where the money had came from. So that's also another thing we need to look at when we...
I didn't think about that. She destroyed that alabaster. She didn't just open it nicely. Over the hotel and keep the body for future. She broke it. We need to destroy our pictures. We pray to God to give us the strength to worship Him that made the heavens and
earth.
It is my prayer that you will be saved from the idol of social media. It is my prayer that we shall, because those are the things that are affecting the present truth believers. They are not affecting those people out there. They are affecting. The devil knows that we read the enemy word very well. We read our Bibles very well. But he has sneaked in something, the smartphone. And he knows we can idolize ourselves all the time. And it's a respectable sin because nobody knows. Everybody's doing it. You do it alone. And nobody will. But you know, if you see me eating this, Sammy, you know, for the help. But if I'm looking at what's up, it's a respectable sin. Sin is sin. We pray for God to help us and find ways to be responsible users of technology to the glory of God and not to our own glory. If you saw somebody walking here, they were telling me that my time is up. So I am hoping that you can. Please.
Just a quick one about social media. Allow me to make this. I work with the media. I attended a seminar 2 years ago. And what they were saying is that in another 3 years, they would like to make sure that families are not talking anymore. And so the social media, the phones and what, they're going to introduce very cheap phones from China. That now everyone, even in the village, will be able to have a smartphone. And when you have that, you're able to then to keep on communicating. There are even restaurants in the U.S. right now where youth are going and you don't have to talk to anyone. All you have to do is to order online and you're not talking to anyone. So you order, you pay, everything is online, you chat with your friends. You are seated together like we are, but you are not able to talk. That is number one. Then the attention level of all our youth has reduced from... Even it was at around 30 seconds before we could even do an ad of 30 seconds. But now you cannot do an ad which is more than, you know, 20 seconds because the attention level has dropped significantly to less than 15 seconds. So anytime you give an ad or communication that is beyond 15 seconds, you can almost be sure that no one will watch it. When we do programs now and ads, they are shorter, they are crispier, they are fresher, they are all those descriptions. So what is the devil doing? Trying to ensure that he captures all our children. So this thing that he's talking about is real, hypnotizing. When you look at the programs that we are introducing on television every day, they have witchcraft. In every 30-minute program, you'll find witchcraft, people talking to the dead. Now you can find, you know, programs like Elena's Ghost, and people love them and they watch them. So that is happening. It is real. It is in the media. So it is, what he's saying is very serious and is very dangerous. So we need to actually just resist from using these things.
And then I called me one time and said, you know, I have a problem with my children. In the evening when they come home, we don't have a family time. They just go to their room, they are on their phones. Mm-hmm. When they come for food, after they finish eating, they go back to their room. Families are not talking.
Yeah.
And, but it is a problem. So it's my prayer that God has shown us, and God renew our minds, let us do whatever is good, whatever is of good report. If there is any batch we need, think about these things. And in that verse I read, that you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is what?
Stayed upon me.
This is my prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you because you love us so much. You'd like us to be restored back to your image. And we promise that you will renew our minds. You will give us a heart of flesh and not a heart of stone that has been corrupted and hardened by the hypnosis of this world. Lord, I know that we have a problem with this social media, with the technologies that have come today that have been used irresponsibly to honor the devil. We pray, Lord, that we may learn to be wise as serpents and gentle as doves, that we can use technology in a sensible way, in a responsible way, to glorify your name, and to avoid all manner of evil and any temptations or any mediums that will tempt us to worship or to worship a false god. I pray, Lord, that you help us to destroy our pictures, to destroy all those idolatries that keep us away from developing good characters for eternity. There is much at stake, and the little things of this world should not come in the way of eternal reality. I pray that you may give us that strength, that we can resolve to give ourselves to you fully, for this is our humble prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.